Aggregate impact value test. This is the first experiment that we will be seeing in the list of experiments or practicals that are prescribed under the transportation engineering course. And basically, as we have discussed, that you have four different materials on which you will be studying the practicals. One is the aggregates, another is the bitumen. Then you have bituminous mix and soil. So amongst the or in the category of aggregates, this is the first test, aggregate impact value test. Before proceeding to the actual test, let's see something regarding mechanical properties of aggregate. So as you all might have seen that in road construction, on surface whatever you see, that is nothing but a mixture of aggregate and bitumen. And also, if you might have noticed that during construction, the layers which are laid beneath the surface layer, those also consist of considerable amount of coarse aggregate. So if you see any normal pavement, it may be a flexible pavement or a rigid pavement or even an earthen road. So majority of the material, if you quantify it, that's aggregate. And that's why it's important that whatever aggregates we use in this construction, those should be of good quality. And by good quality, I mean they should be such that whatever are the loads which are to which the pavement is subjected, so your aggregate should sustain all those loads and then perform well. So in order to do this, we have to test the materials or the aggregates for different properties. And out of those four major properties for which aggregates are tested to be used in pavement are toughness, crushing strength, hardness, and extent of polish under traffic. So amongst this, today we'll be focusing on the toughness property. And in order to find out this toughness of an aggregate, the test that is performed is the aggregate impact value test or AIV test. Now this AIV test, generally it is of two types, further a dry AIV and a wet AIV. So majority of the times dry AIV is performed, and wet AIV it is only performed, or it is only used when you have weak aggregates. So there are some locations in India as well that you have a low quality of aggregate, that is its strength is not that good. So in such cases, if you cannot find a substitute material, or if you cannot improve the quality also, so in that case a wet AIV test is done, and then it is seen that can it sustain through that wet cycle also. So for our test that we are discussing now, so we will not focus on this wet AIV, but whatever is the procedure that I will be explaining, that is related to a dry AIV test. Then the objectives of this practical, so you have two objectives. First is obviously that you have to determine this impact value of the coarse aggregate, and second, you have to assess whether whatever is the value obtained of this impact aggregate or the impact value that is obtained of these aggregates, is that suitable enough, or does it make your aggregate suitable for road construction? And the applicable code is IS 2386 part 4. Now you all must have studied various subjects till now in which you have conducted some practicals, and most of the practicals you might have seen this, that there is a code or a standard through which the procedure you follow. So same is the case with this coarse aggregate as well. So we follow IS 2386, which is the code for aggregate testing, and in that also this part 4 is mainly related to the mechanical properties of aggregate. Then coming to the question that why actually we need to perform this AIV test. So as we have seen that AIV impact value test, it gives you the property, or it evaluates the toughness of an aggregate. Now, why your aggregate need to be tough? Because they are subjected to impact loading on site. So in any experiment that we perform or any practical that we performed on a material which is supposed to be used on site, so we always perform the practical in such a way that the lab conditions, they try to simulate what are the field conditions. So as I told you, on field what happens is, on road your aggregates, they are subjected to impact loading, and that's why we give a impact loading in the lab also, and then we find out the toughness of the aggregates in term of AIA. So now if you think over it, can you think of any instances on site or on field where this impact loading or your aggregates which are used in pavement are subjected to impact loading? So my question is, do you or can you recall any instances on field where your aggregates are subjected to impact loading? So the first one is the compaction of road rollers. So aggregates which are dumped on the site through a dumper or a dozer, so generally they are in a form of a heap first when they are dumped, and later on then that heap is spread using some spreader or scraper. Okay, generally spreader, not scraper also. So when they are spread initially, so they are not in a level form. Okay, so they are just spread randomly, and you can find such ups and downs in it. And when the road roller, it moves on this kind of surface, so what the road roller does is, due to the weight, it makes everything level. So whichever aggregates are loose aggregates which are propping up from the others, so they are pushed down, okay, in order to form a level surface. Now in the process of doing this, what happens is there are small drops to which your road roller is subjected. Okay, now these small drops are just because there is an aggregate in between, suppose here, and your roller has to go over this aggregate. So no doubt that this aggregate will be pushed in the downward direction, but in the process of doing so, there is a small drop by which your road roller, it goes over the aggregates or falls over the aggregate. So even if that drop is not considerable in magnitude, but there is a small amount of impact loading that your aggregates are subjected to while compaction by road roller. So that is one condition where the impact loading is there on your site. The second you can think of is a speed breaker. So in speed breaker, obviously everyone must have seen a speed breaker. So when your vehicles, if this is the direction of travel, so at the starting position the speed is reduced and your vehicles, they roll over this shape. Now if the speed is genuinely reduced to a limit prescribed by the authorities on the road, okay, suppose the authorities intend to reduce the speed of this vehicle or any vehicle traveling over this speed breaker to 20 km/h, so if you travel by that speed, then there is no question of any discomfort to the passenger or the driver. But generally what happens is our speed is a bit on a higher side than the actual intended one. So though the intention of the authorities might be that you should reduce your speed to 10 km/h or even almost 0 km/h, but in actual practice there is some speed to the vehicle when it is traversing over the speed breakers, and due to that what happens is when it leaves this apex or top portion or the crown portion of the speed breaker, the wheel of the vehicle, it is in air or it leaves the contact of the pavement over here, and then it falls on the other side of the speed breaker. So in this situation what happens is your aggregates which are located over here, so they are subjected to this impact loading. Okay, so this you can also experience when, if you have driven a four wheeler or two wheeler, so whenever you cross a speed breaker, and if that speed breaker is in improper shape, or if you are having or if your vehicle is in greater speed, so you feel a discomfort when you are sitting in the vehicle, such vehicle. So that discomfort is nothing but on your side, but on aggregates, that discomfort is caused due to the impact loading. So this is the second case in which there is impact loading on your aggregates. Then third case is in case of a heavy wheel load and fair to poor road conditions, again your aggregates are subjected to impact loading. The best example for this is, everyone knows that in India, every monsoon you see these kind of structures, that there are potholes in your roads. Okay, so in potholes, what happens is, again the same thing will go on, that a wheel is traveling on a level road, but the moment a pothole comes in front of it, your vehicle or the wheel, it goes inside its pothole. Okay? And then again there is a sort of impact loading, okay, because there is a certain depth to this pothole. So due to this impact loading, again the aggregates over here, they are subjected to, or due to this downfall of your wheel, the aggregates over here are subjected to the impact loading. So in case of potholes, what happens is, this impact loading is repetitive at a particular location itself. Okay. So wherever the depth is more, at that location the impact will go on for each vehicle, or each vehicle there will be a repetitive impact loading, and that's why at the same location the aggregates might fail, or they fail, and that's why you see that this pothole then eventually it widens up and deepens in the depth also. Okay, so that is one phenomena where you can see impact loading on your aggregates. And the last one you can think of is in case of a runway. Okay, so runway is the strip of land on which your aircraft will land and take off, but it is nothing but a pavement itself. It might be a flexible pavement or rigid pavement, and the constraint in it, or the main constraint in it is aggregates itself. So on that runway, whenever there is a landing, so there is a huge impact on the runway, and ultimately the huge impact is carried by the aggregates itself. So that is one condition where you can think of a impact loading on your pavement. So these are different actual site conditions in which your aggregates are subjected to impact loading, and that's why it is necessary for us to test the aggregates in lab for impact as well. So this is the theory related to this experiment or practical. Now the apparatus for this experiment, so you first need an impact testing machine which will facilitate you to give the impact loading. Then a cylindrical measure, tamping rod, sieves, weighing balance, and hot air oven. So we'll see each one in detail. So first with the machine. So here you can see three figures or three images. So the first one is a normal line diagram for a aggregate impact testing machine, and the second and third are the actual photographs of the machine. So starting with the base, you have a firm circular base which acts as a foundation or a resting surface for the cup. Now this cup is also known as a testing cup. So in this testing cup, whatever sample you have to test, that is taken. Its dimension is 102 mm in diameter and 50 mm in depth. Then you have a vertical guide bar. Now these vertical guide bars are because you have to give an impact loading to your aggregates. Now impact loading is nothing but whenever a weight is subjected to some movement, either in horizontal direction or in vertical direction or in a swinging manner, if that weight is given this movement, this kind of movement, either horizontal, vertical, or a swinging movement, and then it is applied to the material, then we say that your material is subjected to impact loading. Now one type of impact loading test you have done in your second year under the subject of strength of materials, where you had that isocharpy test. Okay, So that was also an impact test, but only difference was in that the specimen was a metal strip or a metal bar, you can say, which was placed vertically, and then there was a hammer which was swing from a horizontal position or a rest position to the impact was horizontal. The metal was kept vertical and the impact of the hammer was horizontal to it. So that is one way in which you can give impact loading. But now as we have aggregates, so we can't keep that aggregates vertical. So in this case, what we have is the aggregates are kept horizontal and whatever is the impact, it is given in the vertical downward direction. So this is the way that we give the impact loading. So for any impact loading, if you see, if you have to provide an impact load, so you need some weight and you need some drop of that weight. Okay? So that weight should drop through some height. So same is the case here also. In our case, this weight is nothing but a hammer which is weighing around 13.5 to 14 kg, and that hammer is free to move on this vertical guides up and down in such a way that it can fall on the testing cup or on the material inside the testing cup through a height of 380 mm plus or minus 5 mm. So this is that hammer and this is the base of the hammer. Now the base of the hammer, the diameter is 100 mm, and if you see the diameter of testing cup, it's 102. So the diameter is adjusted in such a way that your hammer, when it is impacted on this aggregates, so it can fit inside this testing cup. Now this hammer, it is held in rest position by this interlocking assembly. You will see its demonstration in the video also. And then this hammer, as I told you, it can go up and down. So then this up and down movement is done manually by the lifting handle. So you have to lift it manually, and then due to this interlocking mechanism, it falls or there is a free fall of this hammer. So for lifting purpose, you have this lifting handle. Then you have a safety pin over here. Now this safety pin, as the name suggests, it is for a safety point of view, as in whenever you don't want to use the hammer but you want to use this space at the bottom, or the you have to fit a testing cup or pour some material inside the testing cup, so at that time your hammer, it should not be at the bottom side but it should be somewhere up. Okay, and if it is to be kept at a rest position in the upper side of the machine, then for that the safety pin is used. So the safety pin is a through pin, or it is inserted through this hole. There is a hole over here, and it is inserted in such a way that this lifting handle or this horizontal portion of this lifting handle, it rests on this safety pin. So the moment you remove this safety pin, your hammer will drop freely if you are not holding this lifting handle. So that's the safety pin, and as I told you, you have to drop this hammer so that the impact is due to this distance or the drop of 380 mm. So that 380 mm or the height of the drop, it is adjusted by this adjusting screw which is given at the top. Okay. So this is the line diagram, and in figure number 2 and 3, so in this figure 2 and 3, you will be seeing the actual photographs. So the second figure is when the hammer is in rest position. So you can see the hammer, it is in rest position at the top side. So this is the hammer which is at the top side, and it is held due to this interlocking mechanism. You can see two L-shaped bars which are held or which are interlocked inside each other, and this interlocking mechanism holds the hammer, and ultimately those are connected to this horizontal bar of lifting hammer, and there is a safety pin here over which the lifting handle or the horizontal part of the lifting hammer, it rests. So that's why this is a rest position, and now you are in a position that you can change this cup or you can put some material into this cup. And this third figure is the hammer, again it is in rest position, but this time it is resting at the bottom of the impact testing machine. So in the bottom also it is resting inside the cup. So this is the testing cup that we have seen, and your hammer, it has gone inside this testing cup by traveling some distance, and that distance we have to adjust it to 380 mm. So this is the entire testing machine and different components of that machine. Next we have another small apparatus or accessories for this test that you require. You require a cylindrical measure whose internal diameter is 75 mm and height is 50 mm, and you need a tamping rod, its diameter is 10 mm and length 230. And one peculiar thing about this tamping rod is you have two ends for this rod, but both the ends are different. One of the end is pointed and another end, it is flat and rounded. Okay. So sort of flat and rounded. So its edges are rounded, but its surface is almost flat. So that's the peculiarity of this tamping rod. Then you require sieves. So in all you require three sieves, IS, and you require all this IS sieve, Indian standard sieves. So IS sieve 12.5 mm, 10 mm and 2.36 mm are needed for this experiment. You can see the top view over here. Then you need weighing balance because we'll be recording some weights, and then you need a hot air oven. So this is with the apparatus. Coming to the procedure of this test, now I will be explaining you the procedure in a single slide in a pictorial form, but we will also be seeing the demonstration in the next video. So this is just a short explanation, some theory related to the procedure. So initially we wash the aggregates, whatever we have to test, and oven dry them. Now again, question to you, that why do you think this washing and oven drying would be necessary? So it is necessary because if you have seen the aggregates which come to the site for construction, so they generally come from a crusher, where the crusher is installed either in a quarry site itself, where the huge boulders are excavated from the mountains or hills, and then they are put into the crusher so that it is broken down into smaller pieces of desirable sizes. So in crusher, after crushing, they are stored or they are stacked in form of heaps of aggregate of different sizes, and those heaps are stored maybe for a lot of days or even for months together. So during that process, there is a lot of dust into that area which comes out due to the crushing action. So that dust is accumulated on the surface of the aggregates, and sometimes it also happens that if the aggregates are stored in open in the crusher area for a longer duration, so a thin film of dust is accumulated on these aggregates, and we don't want this dust because eventually what we are going to do is we are going to take some known quantity of aggregates of known size, and then we are going to subject it to impact loading. And as you can guess, that due to that impact loading, the aggregates are going to get crushed or the size is going to get reduced. So in that process, the dust particles which are already there on the aggregates, those will also be incorporated into this crushing or crushed material, and that can give us erroneous readings. So to avoid that, we wash and oven dry these aggregates. Then the next thing is you have to sieve those aggregates through a set of sieves. So at the bottom we have a pan, above which we have a 10 mm sieve and then 12.5 mm sieve. And then after sieving, we take the sample which is retained on IS 10 mm sieve. After that, we fill it in a cylindrical measure. So as you had seen earlier, so cylindrical measure of 75 mm diameter and 50 mm depth. So this cylindrical measure, it is filled in three layers.
So you fill the cylindrical measure 1/3 first, then you give or use the stamping rod and that to the rounded end or flat end of the stamping rod to give 25 strokes so that the surface is level and the aggregates are rearranged. Then you fill the next 1/3 and fill it up to the 2/3 level. Then again repeat the same procedure of tamping it with 25 strokes of the rounded end of tamping rod. And then you fill the remaining material, okay? And you again repeat the same procedure of tamping for 25 times. After that, take a straight edge and then remove the surplus material so that a straight level surface is obtained at the top. After this, you have to, whatever is the aggregate you have taken now, that you have to weigh and note it down as W1 gram. And also after weighing, what you have to do is you have to transfer it from cylindrical measure to the testing cup. Now this is an important thing to understand. Now again, a question for you. Why do you think the procedure asks for first filling the measure, cylindrical measure, and then transferring it to the testing cup? So just to give you a hint, the cylindrical measure, it is having the dimensions as 50 mm depth and 75 mm diameter, and your testing cup, it has the same depth, 50 mm, but it has a slightly greater diameter of 102 mm. So now what I am asking is why we need to first fill this cylindrical measure and then transfer it to the testing cup, and why not we are directly filling this testing cup itself in three layers and then giving each layer this 25 blows of the tamping rod. So that's a question. So the answer to it is that when we, or if we suppose see this condition that you have a testing cup and you have filled it till the top surface with the aggregates, and now you are giving an impact load. Now what I told you, impact load is nothing but a weight of 13 to 14 kg. It is dropping through a height of 380 mm. So the moment it drops, and if your aggregates are filled till the top surface or the brim of the testing cup, so at the first blow itself, a few aggregates, they will spill out, and they will spill out, and then every time you give the blows, you have to collect these aggregates which are spilled out, and then you have to again fill it. So that will be a lot of tedious task, and again, if you don't do so, so in that process, you are reducing the quantity of the sample. And as we have done here, that we have measured the quantity as W1 grams, and that we will be using in the further calculation. So in this process, whatever this filling which takes place, so in due to this, the W1 gram, whatever is the weight, that will no longer remain the same during the testing, and you have to give this 15 blows of this hammer. Okay, so 15 times there will be spilling of the aggregates. So to avoid that, what is done is, when I take fill the aggregates in this cylindrical measure, which is having a depth of 50 mm and diameter 75 mm, and then I transfer it to this testing cup. So now the testing cup has same height, but the diameter is more. So whatever are the aggregates which have been filled in this cylindrical measure up to the top surface, those will occupy, or those will not cover the whole volume of the testing cup, but rather there will be a small, you can say, gap or recess from the top in the surface of the aggregate. So there's a top surface of the aggregate, they will be only till here, and it will not cover the entire testing cup. So you can see in this figure also at the bottom right. So this testing cup is actually blue in color, its paint is blue, but here somewhere you can see that at this level, the paint has been worn off at this bottom portion. So that is because almost every time the level of the aggregates, it is only till here. Now when you fill the aggregates only, or your aggregates, they cover only a part of your height. So now whenever there is an impact, so in that process the hammer will go inside the testing cup and then it will be impacting the surface of the aggregate. So now in this case there is no chance of spilling out because the diameter of the hammer is 100 mm and the diameter of your testing cup is 102, so almost there is a 1 mm gap on each side. That is just for the fitting purpose. So in that case there is no spilling and that's why there is no decrease in this W1 weight. Now after this, then we place the testing cup at the bottom of the impact testing machine and then we adjust the height first. So the height of the drop should be such that the bottom of the or the base of the hammer and the top surface of the aggregate, the distance should be 380 mm. Plus or minus you can have 5 mm of error or tolerance, you can say, not error. And then you have to remove the safety pin after adjusting the height and then you have to give 15 blows. Okay, so 15 times you have to lift this hammer and then it will drop freely through a height of 380 mm on the sample. After that obviously your sample is going to get crushed, so you have to sieve it, but this time through a smaller size sieve, that is 2.36 mm sieve. And then whatever is the sample which is retained on this 2.36 mm sieve, that you note down as W3. And then we proceed towards the calculation. So now you will be seeing the, or next video will be the demonstration of this procedure.
IS sieve 12.5 mm, IS sieve 10 mm, IS sieve 2.36 mm, pan, aggregate sample required for the particle and taken in this tray. This is the cylindrical measure, its diameter is 75 mm and depth is 50 mm. Testing cup, diameter is 102 mm and its depth is 50 mm. This is the tamping rod. This is the aggregate impact test apparatus. Let's see the parts of this apparatus. This is the circular base, testing cup, this is the vertical guide bar, this is the hammer. The hammer is weight, the weight of this hammer is 13.5 to 14 kg and the base of this hammer, this is the base of this hammer and the diameter of this hammer is 100 mm. When we give the blow of, with this hammer, this hammer will fix in this cup. Yep. Lifting handle, this is the safety pin. When this hammer is in resting position, we have to fix this. While giving the blows, we have to take out this safety pin and then give the blow. This is the adjusting screw. This screw is used to adjust the height of the drop of this hammer. The test sample consists of coarse aggregate. These coarse aggregates are washed, then oven dried at 110 degrees Celsius temperature to remove the dust particle. Now, this is the sieve state. This is the pan, this is the 10 mm sieve, and this is the 12.5 mm sieve. The sieving should be done in such a manner that aggregates are subjected to the horizontal, circular, and then upward and downward direction. Now for testing, we require a sample retaining on 10 mm sieve. So this is the sample retained on the sieve. Now this test sample is placed in this measuring cup. One third we have to fill it. After filling one third, we have to give the blows with this tamping rod with this flat edge. Again, you have to fill the measuring cup two third, and again you have to give the 25 blows in this manner. After giving 25 blows, you have to fill the measuring cup and repeat the same procedure. Give the 25 blows. After giving 25 blows, we have to take out the surplus material with the flat edge. Remove this. Now this sample is ready. Now we have to take the weight of this aggregate. Now transfer this sample in this tray and note down this tray in grams. Its weight is 330 grams. Note down this weight as a W1. Now place this testing cup below this hammer. Now transfer this sample in this testing cup. After that, again you have to give the 25 blows with the help of this tamping rod. Now we have to adjust the drop of this hammer, which should be 380 mm. The drop of the hammer is measured from the top of this aggregate to the bottom of this hammer. Now this height is 360 mm. We have to adjust it to 380 mm with this adjusting screw. Now we have adjusted height of this hammer is 380 mm plus or minus 5 mm. After that, you have to take out the safety pin of this lifting handle and then give the gentle blow. Now give the 15 number of blows with this hammer. Now shift this sample in the sieve, which is the 2.36 mm sieve. Now take out the sample with the edge of this tamping rod, like this. You have to take out. After that, you have to sieve this sample. And the sample written on the sieve 2.36 mm sieve is note down as a W3. Now take the weight of this written sample. This weight we have to note down as a W3.
Now we have seen the demonstration. Now what remains is the calculation part. So we started our experiment with the objective that you have to find out the aggregate impact value of your aggregates, and for that this is the formula that AIV is equal to W2 upon W1 into 100. Now W1, if you recall, that was the weight of the aggregate sample which was taken in the cylindrical measure.
before the test, before we actually transferred it to the testing cup. So we have that as W1. Then after giving the impact blows of 15 blows, we sieved the sample through 2.36 mm sieve, and then whatever was the sample retained on this 2.36 mm sieve, so that we recorded as W3. Now, during the demo video, you might have noticed, or you should have noticed something related to the crushed sample, that we are not recording this W2 weight, okay, at all. Nowhere in the procedure we have recorded the weight W2, but in the calculation we take this W2 for calculation purpose. You don't take W3. But now again, a question for you, that why we have not measured, actually physically measured this weight, or why haven't we measured the weight of the sample which has passed through 2.36 mm sieve and retained on the pan? Why we have not done so? So the answer to this is that, if you might have seen in the demonstration video carefully, so when it was shown that the crushed sample is removed from the testing cup, it is taken into the 2.36 mm sieve and then it is sieved. So you might have seen a lot of dust particles which have gone into the air while transferring the sample as well as while sieving the sample. Now, even if you put a lid over the sample while sieving, if you think that that will solve the problem, but then too, when you open the, after sieving, when you open the lid, there is a gush of dust which goes into the air, and also there is a dust which goes off while transferring the sample from the testing cup to the sieve. So in that process, we might lose some sample in the process of transferring, and that's why we never take the passing weight. We always take the retaining weight, because the retaining sample on 2.36 mm sieve, it's quite large in quantity, or the size of the aggregate is a considerable size which doesn't go off in the air in the form of dust. So that's why this we get an accurate reading. This we have an accurate reading, and W2 we cannot get accurate reading because most of it is in a form of dust which is formed due to crushing. So that's why we avoid taking W2, and what we do is we take W3 instead, and then simply for finding out W2, you subtract W1, or you subtract W3 from W1. So your AIV formula, you can just simply change it to AIV is equal to W3 minus W1. Sorry, W1 minus W3 upon W1 into 100. So this will give you the ratio, which is nothing but, or this will give you the percentage, which is nothing but the AIV value of the aggregates. So for this experiment, or for this demonstration purpose, we showed you just one reading, but similarly we performed this test thrice, because generally we take average of three readings to be sure that statistically it's correct, and we have taken, or we have incorporated all the, or we have incorporated the process with minimum error. So that's why we take three readings. So for the first demonstration purpose, you have seen that your W1 was 330 grams, then your W3 was 294, and which gave you the W2 values 36, and it worked out to be 10.91% AIV. So similarly, these two values were also calculated by measuring the W1 and W3, and then an average of all these three readings gives you 11.48. So here we satisfy, or we conclude to our first objective, that we had to find out the aggregate impact value, and now this is the aggregate impact value, 11.48%. Now comes the second objective, that we have to assess the suitability of this aggregate. So whether these aggregates, which are having the value of 11.48% AIV, so are they suitable or not for the construction? So to assess the suitability, what you need is some standards or some specifications or some benchmark values which will tell you whether your 11.48% is a justifiable value to be used in construction or not. So as you can see here, There are two tables shown here. The first table is depending on the impact value, it tells you the classification of your aggregates. So whether they are exceptionally strong, strong, satisfactory or weak for road surface. So if you see on the values on the left hand side, so if your AIV is less than 10, so it's exceptionally strong. 10 to 20, it's strong aggregate. 20 to 30, it's satisfactory. And greater than 35, they are weak aggregates. So if your value of AIV it is greater than this 35, then we don't suggest it for road surface. So here you can also notice that there is a gap of 5%. So from 30 to 35 there is nothing, but 30 to 35 also it becomes a weak range also. So we generally avoid that also, but in worst condition, if you don't have a substitute, then we can consider the value of 35% as well. Okay. But this is just a classification to tell whether or what kind of aggregates we have. Okay. The actual specifications are recommended by either IRC, that is the Indian Road Congress, or the Ministry of Road Transport. So this table over here, the second table at the bottom, this is the table for IRC recommendations. So depending on the type of pavement or in which surface you are going to use this aggregates, IRC has suggested the maximum AIV values. Okay. So for bituminous surface dressing or bituminous penetration macadam, bituminous carpet concrete or cement concrete wearing course, you have a maximum AIV allowable as 30%. Now this wearing course is nothing but the topmost layer of your pavement, any pavement. It may be a cement pavement, cement concrete or bituminous one. So the top surface is the wearing course. So if you are using the aggregates on that top surface, so they are naturally subjected to more impact loading as compared to the aggregates which are in bottom layers. So there you have a maximum AI value allowed is 30. So above that you cannot use the aggregates on the top surface, but you can use those aggregates having value more than 30 in the bottom layers, such as the base course or the WBM or waterborne macadam, and again a base course over here. And the second standards or second specifications are as per the specification for road and bridge work. So this is a specification book which is published by Ministry of Road Transport and Highways, also known as MORTH. So in this book there are specifications for all the materials which are possibly used in road and bridge construction. So in that they have mentioned that you can, or whatever is the aggregates to be used in WBM or WMM or BM. So these are different kinds of bituminous mix and bituminous layer. Basically WBM and WMM, they are the types of base course, and bituminous macadam are different types of binder course. So for that a 30% value is recommended. For DBM and SDBC, so this is the binder course, for this 27%, and for bituminous concrete it is 24%. So if you see bituminous concrete, it is a surface course, okay, which is the topmost layer. DBM, it is generally used in a binder course. Okay. Binder course, it comes below the surface course, and WBM, WBM, they are the base course. So if I just draw the diagram over here of a typical cross section. So you have a surface course, then you have a binder course, then you have a base course, then a subbase one, and then you have a subgrade layer at the bottom. So you see, as we go, or at top surface you have a value of 24% allowable for AIV. More than that you are not allowed to use in surface course. For binder course, the maximum value is 27%, and for base course it's 30%. So you can see, as we go towards the lower layers, so there is a relaxation in your AIV value, because the sole reason for it is that your surface course is, it is subjected to impact loading, more impact loading as compared to the binder course and base course. In these two course, the loading or impact loading will come only in case when there is a construction, or during construction when there is a use of road roller. So only then the impact will be there. Otherwise all the other kinds of impact of speed breakers and heavy loads and potholes, that will be subjected, or that will be taken by only the surface force. So depending on the specifications and the value that we have, so we have got a value of 11.48%. So according to that, we can classify that our aggregates are strong because they lie between this range of 10 to 20%. Then its value is well below 30%, so it can be used in the bearing course or the topmost surface as per the IRC as well as per the MORTH. So it can happen sometimes that if the value of AIB value of an aggregate sample is suppose 27%, so you might not use it in the surface course, but you can use it in the binder course as per MORTH. But as per IRC, you can use it in the surface course as well. So generally on site, this is the specification which is preferred. So whatever the specification by suggested by this book of Ministry of Road Transport and Highways, so those specifications are preceded over any other on site. So this is the conclusion of this experiment or practical, that our aggregate sample, it had a AIB value of 11.48%. So it those are the strong aggregates which may be used in the surface course of pavement construction.